All right, so we're now going to be looking more into some of the basics of foundation, I guess, that we're going to need for some of the things we'll be talking about, especially when we look at cell wall construction of different microbes, how they're treated, how do we attack them, basically, how do they get around our defenses. So some of this information may seem a little unnecessary, but it really is important to make sure that you understand this information so that we can build on this. So we won't go over too many chemical concepts in this class, but biomolecules are really important in understanding cellular macromolecules. All organisms are constructed from four basic types of biological molecules, okay? And we call these macromolecules. Macro meaning large, okay? So there's four types here. We have carbohydrates, lipids, proteins, and nucleic acids, all right? All but lipids are actually polymers, and so they're made from smaller repeating units that we call monomers, all right? So we looked at these three, carbs, lipids, and proteins, quite a bit in anatomy, and we'll look at nucleic acids a little bit more in this section, but we will cover all of them. Proteins are a good example of a polymer. They're made from linking together amino acids, which would be the monomer in this unit. All right, so we're going to look at some of those, some things you will have heard from anatomy if you've taken anatomy, but we will have a little bit different focus. So here, this describes the basic structure, some examples, and why they are important. And so I don't read straight from these because I know that if you're in college, you can obviously read, right? But it is important to look at this material and be sure you understand what we've got going on, all right? We're going to do things where we look at if bacteria are able to break down and metabolize lactose or sucrose or fructose, okay? We're going to look at whether or not a microbe has DNA or RNA, and is it a retrovirus where it actually converts from one to another? So this information is important. Do be sure that you read it, but I'm never going to just read a chart to you, okay? I may point out a couple things, but don't ever assume that you don't need to go through this and study these. Carbohydrates are combinations of carbon, which is where we get the portion of the word carbo, and water, which is where hydrate comes from. Carbohydrates are represented by this formula here, CH2O, and then N is the number of those units that you have. Okay, so you could multiply those atoms by whatever this number is. All right, so these sugars that are listed here are some important monosaccharides. So we have hexose, hex meaning six, pentose meaning five carbons, okay, six carbons, five carbons. Glucose, which is the most common and universally used and important, therefore, hexose that we have, and you've heard of glucose. Fructose, of course, is fruit sugar. We have xylose, which comes from the Greek word for wood. Lactose, which is milk sugar, maltose, malt sugar, and then sucrose, which is what we call our normal table sugar. Some carbohydrates do, by the way, contain some sulfur and some nitrogen on them as well. Cell walls in plants and many microscopic algae actually get their strength from the rigidity that is given to those cell walls by cellulose. And this is actually what we call soluble fiber in our diet, cellulose. It's a very long, you can see here, polysaccharide. So it's made of many of those repeating units of mono or disaccharides. All right, so we link those all together. We use agar here. This is an important part of a component of what we're going to call our culture media. So this is what we grow our bacteria on. It's a polysaccharide. Chitin is another important polysaccharide here. This is found in the cell walls of fungi. One that is really important and that you're going to get tired of hearing about is peptidoglycan, and that's a very important component of the bacterial cell wall. You will see that we use this attribute to help us to determine or classify, I should say, certain types of bacteria. Okay. Helps us identify them. And then we have a glycocalyx. Is going to be a sugar-based molecule, and that helps with attachment of cells to other cell surfaces. So these are some important polysaccharides that we're going to talk about. So triglycerides are our fats, and oils. This is a very important storage lipid. They're made of one glycerol bound to three fatty acids. And you can see this is the glycerol portion here. And here are the three fatty acids, all right? And so this is the process here that we're making a triglyceride. All right. Fatty acids can be saturated or unsaturated, and the degree of saturation depends on the number of bonds. So this one here on the left, this is a saturated fatty acid. That means it has all the possible hydrogens that it can have attached to it. An unsaturated fatty acid is going to have these double bonds here. And so instead of a hydrogen here, and instead of a hydrogen here, you have a double bond. So it is unsaturated. It does not have all the possible hydrogens that it could have attached because it has a double bond. And carbon can only have four bonds around it. And so you can see that this changes the structure. And if you've ever been in my class, you know that structure determines, hope you said it, function, all right? And so it's very easy to see how these would stack up really well. So now think of a nice flat book. That's going to stack together really well. They're going to lay on top of each other and stack really well. The unsaturated, though, these have kinks, and I like to relate this to kind of like a binder that's uneven. You know, binders kind of have a triangular shape like this. Those don't stack up so well, okay? And so it's that degree of saturation that affects that, okay? It's the double bonds there that are in pink. There's three of those double bonds. So anyway, I don't want to get into too much of that, but you do have fats that are stored in these long, stored long-term as droplets or globules, all right? But you also have way more bang for your buck with a fat, okay? And so this is why if we eat too many fats in our diet, we get a little fat, okay? You're gonna have twice as much energy per gram as any other storage molecule. So these can really store some energy. So one of the most important functions of a lipid is to be a phospholipid in a membrane. Many membranes are made of phospholipids, especially our cells are going to be made of a phospholipid bilayer. Okay, so that's really important because that's what protects the cell environment. And so membrane lipids are going to be made by these little phospholipids where you're going to have this little head that kind of has a negative charge that's going to be attracted to a water molecule. So we call that hydrophilic, which means water loving. And then you're going to have these tails that don't really have a charge, and they're going to be hydrophobic, so water fearing. So when these guys are exposed to an aqueous or water-based solution, the heads are attracted to the water, the non-polar tails are going to be repelled for water, and so they actually will form this double bilayer, which I believe is on another slide or two. Okay, so this allows them to be the main constituent of all cell membranes. And basically, you could look at it this way: you're going to have the head out here, and then the tails, and just in case it's not showing, and this out here, and then so you're going to have this go all the way down, and it's going to form this membrane. That membrane is also going to control what comes in and out of the cell. Very important. Okay, so yes, here is this bilayer right here. You can see you have the heads oriented to the outside, the tails oriented to the inside. So this is the phospholipid bilayer. Okay, so if you haven't been in biology for a while, or perhaps anatomy, you may not remember that. Okay, so let's see. Here we have the phospholipid right here. Okay, and so you have the polar head, all right, and the non-polar tails. And this is kind of showing you what that structure is. This is a long chain of hydrocarbons. This one would be saturated, this one would be unsaturated. And the bilayer is formed with the heads on the outside and the tails on the inside of this double layer. And that forms the boundary of the cell membrane. Steroids and waxes are also really important components. A steroid is this silic ring-based compound that is found in cell membranes and often acts as hormones, all right? Cholesterol is a very important steroid that reinforces or gives some solidity, some structure here. There's one right there to the cell membranes. The cell membrane is not rigid, it's flexible. And so, because we don't have cell walls like plants do, we have to be able to add some strength. And we do that by using steroids, okay? Waxes are what we call an ester, which is an organic term, so don't worry about that too much, but it's an ester form between a long chain alcohol and a saturated fatty acid. These are really important for things like waterproofing, found in fur, feathers, fruit leaves, human skin, intact exoskeletons, that type of thing. Okay. This is kind of important because it's found in the cell wall of bacteria that cause tuberculosis, leprosy, and it contributes to their pathogenicity. In other words, how sick they can make you. Proteins are very important molecules, and we make many, many things from proteins. The building blocks of proteins are amino acids, and various combinations of these amino acids give us all the different variety of proteins that we have. There's 20 amino acids, but hundreds of proteins, okay? And so this is the predominant organic molecule found in the cell. So what is an organic molecule? You're probably thinking about going to the grocery store and buying something that is organic, which means pesticide-free, that type of thing. But that's the everyday connotation of the word. The scientific meaning here is it is carbon and hydrogen containing, okay? And so we have some different types of proteins, and really this is all about size. Proteins are all different, by the way, because of their different structure. And remember, structure determines function. The way a protein folds, all right, so we're going to look at the different levels of protein structure. We're going to review that. Basically, the way it folds is going to be related to its structure or shape, which is then going to dictate its function, or you could say vice versa. Okay. And so we have a few different ways of classifying proteins here. You have a peptide, which is a short protein. Basically, it's going to have little short chains of amino acids. A polypeptide, which means many peptides, is going to have more than 20. And if we're going to say protein and be particular about it, then we would say more than 50 amino acids. So really, I kind of use these words interchangeably: peptide, protein, polypeptide. It's really all just about size. Okay. So reviewing the different levels of protein structure, it's important to understand how proteins are put together so we understand what happens when we do things like heat them up or when they come into contact with acid, because these are ways that we can, one, get rid of bacteria or microbes, all right? And they're really important in other metabolic ways as well. And so the primary structure of a protein is, this is kind of the basic structure, how protein starts out is going to be the order of amino acids, okay? So each of these little beads, so to speak, here is an amino acid, and the number and order that they go in is what determines the rest of the structure of a protein. So when a protein is made, it is spit out, so to speak, in this particular order it's coded for, all right? Your DNA codes for every protein, it's coded for to go in this order and to produce this many, okay? Then that is going to be what the rest of the structure of the protein is based on. The secondary structure of a protein is the first folding, so to speak, okay? And this happens because the amino acids, each amino acid has this basic structure, okay? And you're going to have a carbon here in the middle, you're going to have a functional group here, and a functional group here, and a hydrogen here, and I shouldn't say functional group. Actually, you're going to have an amine group, an H2, and a carboxylic acid, which is COO. We'll just put the double O here. And then this section here, that's what makes each amino acid different. I relate this to kind of like one of those drills that has the different bits. It can have a little molecule on here like this, or it can have a great big molecule on the end, or it can have a molecule that has different shapes, that different thing. So there's 20 of those that are different, okay? So each one is a little unique. That unique place is going to be right here at the top. Okay. And so those functional groups have different atoms, and so you're going to have different interactions. You're going to have what we call hydrogen bonding occur. And that's the most important type of bonding for the secondary structure of an amino acid. All right. So this is when it, once it comes out, it's going to fold and it's going to be based on those functional groups. Do they have a positive charge? Do they have a negative charge? But what we're primarily talking about here is hydrogen bonds for the secondary structure. And that is when hydrogen bonds with and in the body is just going to be oxygen and nitrogen. I still use the acronym from chemistry, FON, F-O-N. Oh, sorry, that went a little wild. Because it's also fluorine, but in the human body, we're pretty much concerned only with oxygen and nitrogen. So you're going to have hydrogen on one of these groups, and you can kind of see that here. Hydrogen on one of these groups is going to bond with the oxygen on another, and that's going to cause it to form these two particular shapes. This one here, which is going to be the beta pleated sheet, and then this one here is going to be called the alpha helix, and that's going to be a helix where it's like coiled. So that is the secondary structure. The tertiary structure is going to be the where the additional folding that occurs because of those functional groups. And this is where we're going to see the things like those positive and negative charges I mentioned. And then some other things. You can also have a disulfide bond, which is this one here where you have two sulfurs that bond together. Okay. And you can have some other interactions as well. And that's going to take these alpha helixes and beta pleated sheets. Like you can see a beta pleated sheet here. Here's an alpha helix. Here's another alpha helix. It's going to take those and cause them to fold up more and give it this overall, what we would say, globular structure. And yes, the term is globular, and shape of the protein. So you can see that has kind of a specific shape to it. So all proteins have a primary, secondary, and tertiary structure. Not all proteins, however, have quaternary structure, but some do. So let's look at that. So the quaternary structure is where you take one of those globular proteins and put it together with another globular protein or more. So two or more polypeptides that form a larger multi-protein unit. One that happens to do this is hemoglobin. It has four units. It will have two that are just alike right here and two that are just alike right here with a little heme group in them, okay? And so this is really important to the function of this protein. And so that's going to be really important. As you can see, each protein is going to kind of develop its own unique shape. Its surface is also going to display a distinct pattern here of like little infoldings or pockets here, okay, and bulges out. And so it's going to have a difference in surface than any other protein, all right? So proteins can only interact with molecules that fit their particular surface features. And we say a lot, it's like a lock and a key, okay? And so this is where that structure determines functions. So if we want to look at, say, for instance, an enzyme, and we'll get into these in way more detail later on, let's say it has this particular shape, okay? Well, you're going to need something that has that particular shape to match, all right? And so enzymes, like we could say this is an enzyme, they provide a place for a chemical reaction to occur. They are what we call a catalyst, and a catalyst will speed up a reaction without being used up, all right? This is an example here of a protein. This is an antibody, and it has kind of this classic Y shape that we think of when we look at antibodies here, okay? You'll get familiar with this little shape here. These are glycoproteins. They do have specific regions that will match the structures for attachment for bacteria, virus, and other microorganisms, okay? So proteins can only interact with those that they fit, and we have actually antibodies that can fit any particular structure that we could come in contact with. We may only have one of them, but our body is unique and fascinating that it has all of these different antibodies that can protect us. So when we're talking about proteins, we want to be sure that we understand what denaturation is, because this is really important, because this can stop the functioning of a protein because it breaks down the shape of the protein. So the native state is going to be the 3D form, remember that tertiary structure at least, that's the 3D form of the protein, so that 3D shape, okay? So it's going to have this 3D shape, and you can see this has a particular shape to it here. Okay, kind of like I outlined it before. It's got a particular shape here to it, okay? And that shape is going to determine what it interacts with. And so we can denature it. We can break those bonds, those hydrogen bonds, the sulfide bonds. We can break those bonds down by applying these things here okay, which will cause that protein to become unfolded. All right. And so you can see that this no longer has the same shape. I mean, this is a very different shape here. Okay. So it's not going to function anymore. Most of the time, denaturing is permanent. So if you add heat, if you change the pH too much, too high, or too low, it doesn't have to just be acid. Alcohol, even some disinfectants can denature a protein. That would be a good thing if we're trying to kill bacteria, right? But a bad thing if it's happening to our cells. So we're moving on. We're covering a lot of just little basic things. And then, of course, we're going to get into more detail about some of these later. And some of these, this is as detailed as you need to get. So, nucleic acids, that was our fourth group. I said we talked about the first three a lot in anatomy because we looked at them with digestion. We're going to spend more times with nucleic acids here because this is what is important about things like viruses that has to be copied. So DNA, of course, and RNA are two really important representatives of that fourth type of macromolecule. ATP is also a nucleic acid and is also very important. Okay, we need DNA for hereditary purposes. That's how we pass on those detailed instructions. RNA is going to be responsible for carrying out those instructions, translating that programming language, so to speak, into those proteins that can actually then perform your life functions. So, briefly looking at some of the differences here for DNA, we have A, T, C, and G, adenine, thymine, cytosine, and guanine, which are the bases, okay? And so the base pairs form what we call the rungs of a ladder, if this was a ladder. And then the backbone here is the sugar phosphate part. Okay, so adenine always pairs with thymine, so A always goes with T, and then C, cytosine, always goes with guanine, and C with G for DNA. Okay, and they pair this way because each shares an oxygen, nitrogen, and hydrogen atom. So you have that hydrogen bonding here holding DNA together. So that's really important. Okay, and so they are aligned according to that bonding. Another important part here is that pairing occurs in a very predictable pattern, and the DNA here, your strand is going to actually, when it's uncoiled, is very, very long. So DNA is like our original that we keep locked up tight in the safe, and RNA is basically like a copy. Okay, so we have different types of RNA. We have mRNA, tRNA, rRNA, and then there's actually lots more. We have double-stranded, all types of different things, but we're not going to get into all of those. RNA is single-stranded. Uracil will replace thymine, so instead of T's, we'll have U's. mRNA is messenger RNA, and that's a copy of a gene that takes that information for the order and type of amino acids in a protein. It's going to carry that information, and then transfer RNA is going to actually go get the amino acids together for protein assembly, and that is this one right here. And then rRNA is going to be ribosomal RNA. That's where we make our ribosomal subunit, is the major component of ribosomes. And then we have some other types of RNA, as I said, that act to regulate genes and gene expression. Okay, so ATP is the energy currency of our cells. This molecule, adenosine triphosphate, is going to be, you're going to have, first off, you're going to have a base, you're going to have a ribose sugar, and then three phosphate groups. This squiggly looking bond you see right here means it's a high energy bond. Okay, so this is a high energy compound that's going to give off energy when the second or third phosphate is broken off. Okay, and this energy is going to be used to drive cellular reactions, which is really important. And yes, I say really important a lot. Okay, but it is truly very important. All right, so what are some of the characteristics of cells? All right, and so we are, like I said, we're kind of taking a broad sweep and going over some basics here. The bodies of some living things like bacteria or protozoa are formed from one single cell, while more complex organisms like plants and animals are formed from trillions of cells. Okay, so bacteria and protozoa, one cell, animals and plants, we have 70 trillion cells to make up a human being. All right, So some of the different characteristics of cells are they have a shape to them, spherical, polygonal, cuboidal, cylindrical. They contain a protoplasm encased in a cell membrane. They have chromosomes that contain DNA, ribosomes for protein synthesis, and they're kind of complex in function. So that's kind of the basic characteristics. And now we're going to look at some of the differences. All right, so let's look at those differences. Animals, plants, fungi, protozoa, these are all made up of eukaryotic cells, true nucleus. These contain internal membrane-bound organelles that perform very specific functions like growth, nutrition, or metabolism. The DNA is going to be found in chromosomes. You're going to have ribosomes for protein synthesis, Golgi apparatus, endoplasmic reticulum, vacuoles, and mitochondria. Okay. Bacteria and archaeal cells are going to be where they have no nucleus. They don't have membrane-bound organelles. They have a complex structure, but no nucleus and no organelles. Okay, but they can still engage in the same functions or activities as eukaryotic cells. So really important for our studies is to understand how to classify or identify microorganisms, right? We can't treat them if we don't know what they are. Well, the science of classifying living things is taxonomy. Carolus Linnaeus gave us the basic rules for classification and came up with categories for classification, known as taxa. So many things are known by a common name, kind of like we have common uses for everyday terms. Scientifically, it can be a little bit different. But there's a common name based off of like dominant features. So say like a black-eyed Susan or red-headed blackbird, okay? So microorganisms can also have informal names like brewer's yeast. Brewer's yeast is Acarus saccharomyces cerevisiae, okay? And so we need to learn the scientific name and use our scientific names in class. So here are just some definitions here. Nomenclature, that's the assignment of scientific names to different taxon. All right. And then classification and identification. So we have a binomial system of nomenclature, bi meaning two, the assignment of scientific names to different taxonomic categories and individual organisms. That's that nomenclature. Some of the names come from things like the scientist who discovered the microbe, but often and really importantly, the name tells us about some characteristic of the microbe, like the shape, or the color, or even the disease that it causes. So Staphylococcus aureus is a really good example of that. That tells us three things about this particular bacteria. Staph means clusters, bunch of grapes, okay? And so you're gonna have clusters of berry-shaped, because coccus means berry-shaped around. So you're gonna have clusters that look like, it looks like a basically like a cluster of grapes. And then when it grows, it's going to have a golden color to it. The bacteria, the lawn is what we would say. If bacteria will have a golden color to it, because aureus means golden. And so that tells us a lot about that particular bacteria. Another good example would be Lactobacillus San Francisco. Lacto, what do you think? Lactose, milk, sugar, milk. So lacto means milk. Bacillus is another shape, and that's going to be rod shape. This bacterial species is used to make sourdough bread rise, and that's where the San Francisco comes from, because San Francisco is known for their sourdough bread. Okay, so you will need to be sure that when you write or type these, that you use the correct format here. Scientific names are italicized, okay, which you can only do on a computer. You can try to write in italics in handwriting, but it doesn't count. Okay, so if they're printed, they must be underlined, which is hard to see, but if you look, you can see this is underlined. Okay, when abbreviated, the genus name is always genus and species, and I'm using my mouse like you can see it. Genus and species, okay. The genus name is going to be abbreviated to the first initial. So Escherichia coli is what is commonly called E. coli. It's much easier to say E than Escherichia, right? All right, so looking at classification, this is kind of the general scheme that we used. so we have, they're going to be organized from the highest or the most inclusive group, which is going to be domain. Remember, we only have three domains, okay? And then that's going to go all the way down to the smallest or the most specific category, which is species, all right? And so there's an acronym to help you remember this. It's Dear King Philip Came Over for Grape Soda. So you should know these, domain being the highest, species being the narrowest definition of the word. Using these pictures, especially in this textbook, are really, really helpful. Look at them, study them, read what's written about them, and try to understand the concepts through the visuals, okay? So let's look at the taxonomic breakdown of a human versus a protozoan. They're both eukaryotes, so they both have a true nucleus. They're in the same domain, which is eukarya. However, they are in different kingdoms. Okay, so kingdom Protista over here, kingdom Animalia, and here again, Protista over here, and Animalia over here. And so what did we say? It was Dear King Philip Came Over for Grape Soda. So looking at the human, okay, the human is multicellular, and protozoa are single cellular. So that is why humans are in kingdom Animalia and protozoa are going to be in kingdom Protista. Humans are from phylum Chordata because we have a vertebral column. All right, that's what Chordata means. Then the class is going to be Mammalia. So they have hair and suckle their young. All right, and so here we see we've got humans, we've got dogs, we have lemurs, and we have gorillas. Very different species still here, right? So family then next is going to be Hominidae, all right? And you can see we are now narrowed down to humans and apes only. Then genus is going to be Homo, okay? That is all humans that have ever lived. And sapiens is going to be species. Sapiens means wise. Homo sapiens are the current human status. We also have many others, Homo habilis, Homo erectus, which is the name they gave when men first began to stand upright. I can't think of any others, but I want to say there's like 14 different ones, okay? But that's just really how you use this chart, okay? So the study of phylogeny is then going to be looking at that taxonomic scheme that represents how things are related between groups of living beings, all right? It's also really important that we understand evolution. We know that hereditary information of living beings is going to change through time. Remember, evolution is just change over time. That's going to give us different structure and functional changes over the generations. And the driving force for that, remember, is going to be natural selection. Okay. And that's going to be things that are favored that favor what we call evolutionary fitness, which is survival and reproduction. So we looked at it earlier and we'll look at it again, but the first tree of life was based on just two kingdoms. Even when I was in high school, and I'm aging myself here, we didn't have domains. We had the kingdoms, okay? So I have to be careful. Sometimes I flip back to that in my mind. And so these were based on morphological characteristics. Morphological doesn't mean change. It means shape, okay? So soon it was easy to see that microorganisms, once we discovered them, did not really fit into the other categories. And so we added protozoa and then monera. And then lastly, we added fungi. So fairly recent, and I mean fairly recent since it has changed since I was in high school, discoveries in genetics led to the major overhaul of these taxonomic or systematics classifications because we looked at their RNA sequences. So things that we thought were really closely related were not as closely related as we thought because we were just looking at morphology. We weren't looking at genetics, all right? So that's when we came up with the new system of the three domains, bacteria, archaea, and eukarya, okay? Eukaryota, it just kind of depends on the textbook and how you use it. So that kind of wraps up chapter one here. So I hope you kind of get the gist of how this is going to work. You're going to need to go on and watch the other chapters and take notes there as well. Take the practice quizzes. They are very, very helpful. You will not see every single test question on there, but you will, if you go through the quizzes enough, you're going to see most of them and you'll get used to the style of questions as well. And if you miss something, you can go and look at what the right answer is. I don't give you the right answer, but you can go and find it. All right.